budget that we're trying to teach with. That's the school now. Trying to draw some graphs. So, just like a little bit about the final thing I have, but we'll be about. And then try to work through some of the main graphs. Those are the bulk of ones. But that is something that I thought we learned. So, I was on Tuesday, yeah, which is early for us, recently in Tibia. And I don't know if I'll talk tomorrow. Then as well. The final will be not dissimilar to the midterm, kind of a few definitions of key terms. I put another set of terms up on the website for the final. I made some of the graphs, and I made those graphs for the main two parts of the midterm. So, we'll have more graphs, be able to draw the graphs, show the different points on the graphs, label them well, think about all the elements of the graphs, label the curve, label the axes, label the points, label the equilibria, label the triangles, the lost triangles. And then there'll be probably some math problems where it's like the concepts on set, a little bit 3, 4, and 5 will be elements of like solving a simple problem for an efficient point and what the correct solution should be. And then some questions just provide discussion that can you solve it, show why this is, or show why, you know, a firm would prefer this, like the way the process goes. So as far as things to study from, I put another review sheet on the website, I just list the terms and I'll take a walk through that. Certainly look at the problem sets and the last three problem sets, and specifically, there'll be problems like that on the final. Another place to look at is the problem sets are coming from the back of the chapters of the textbook, so you can look at the problem sets in the textbook and look through those. Finally, there's a whole bunch of resources on Peter Burke's website. So, Peter Burke's the author of this book, the person who's on sabbatical, who I've taken his class, and let's see if I can do this, turn on here. So here's his website. I think if you just Google Peter Burke, it'll come up, but Peter Burke is at Gary Burke, the EDOR department. And if you go down, there's the problem sets, there is a list of presentations, which many of mine are coming from. If you get down here, there's a bunch of old finals and old midterms, answer keys for old midterms. There's no answer keys for the finals, but this is just a place to look for other exams. They're all here, they're all old versions of problems. So if you need more resources, you can look through this. And generally, this class is sort of following along with the first version of the class. So we were in Keynote. And I'm going to switch to this new program and hope that it works. It's so list of terms. The first page is about list of terms. I'm saying that we have the midterm. So we have supply and demand curve. Prices, movements along supply and demand, shifts of supply and demand, market demand versus individual demand, summation, horizontal summation, vertical summation, complementary goods substitutes, normal and inferior goods. And then within consumer theory, I'll go and do this fast today, but we have indifference curves, consumption bundles, consumer preferences, and then properties of indifference curves, like what they're shaped like, what they look like, and then how we get demand curves from indifference curves. Which is a work in class, and it's also a book. So we need that at different places when there's a line, and indifference curves are tangent. We can vary the price and get a demand curve back from them. Definitely need to know the triangles of welfare analysis. So right under our demand curve, we have different triangles there. The demand curve is the length of the pay line. Definitely need to know consumer surplus triangle, producer surplus triangle, demand loss triangle, how to draw those on the supply and demand curve. What a change, what a tax would do, what a change in demand would do to change the shape of those surplus. We also have the problem set. Price discrimination, how the producer can take away the consumer surplus by charging different prices. And then demand analysis, and really this was more stuff in the first part of the semester, you just know these terms, but don't get too deep into them. Then we have a firm theory, we have isoproduct lines, we have total physical product, we have rate of technical substitution between different inputs, we have returns to scale. Then all the things we have on the midterm, like fixed cost, average variable cost, average fixed cost, and then the shutdown point, where does economic profit, and long run versus short term economic profit. I think I'm going to just go through the terms really quickly. Looking at markets, we talk about market power, perfect competition versus whether it's market power with the monopoly or an oligopoly. You have the cost curves, margin revenue, marginal cost within the monopoly, and why or why not they would be trade efficient. And then this is sort of the bulk of what we're doing in the second half of the quarter is the sale of taxes and pollution, private costs versus social costs, finding the efficient amount of pollution, how a tax can get us to the efficient point. We have the welfare, how the welfare affects taxes, is it the consumer surplus or producer surplus? And then we have different ways to get to the efficient point, including technology standards, emission standards, input taxes, output taxes, and trading permits. So in what we worked on the problem side, we could show that profits went, producers prefer different instruments based on how to affect their profits. And generally, some of them fit under market-based solutions, permanent subsidies, and price profit are market-based solutions. And we find those efficient points through marginal cost of payment, marginal benefit of payment. And moving to that marginal, once we have those payment curves, we can enter in this closing world where we have two different firms within one world. They can each have a marginal cost of payment specific to each firm and trade to get to the efficient point. Maybe the transaction costs are lower, and there's a property rights regime for trading. And then I just made a bunch of terms for the stuff that I talked about, the Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, and we can do that and talk about this after. Then we had a section on interest rates and cost benefit analysis. So at present, there's some simple formulas. Present value and future value are related by the interest rate at the time. We have this annual value, present value, and we have an annual value in the future. We have real versus nominal versus using prices, real versus nominal prices. We talked a lot about what would happen if a high interest rate versus a low interest rate, what interest rate would private sector use versus what interest rate would the public sector use. And then we have interest rates that we can solve for the internal rate of return, so that's solving for the interest rate itself by showing how what the project costs are. Then we'll talk about the levelized costs for, and we do that for power production. And then we get these phenomenal resource model and renewables resource model. That next simple biological models we can have. And then the last few weeks of class, we talked about water, some specifics for water in California. What should the price of water be? What is the price of water? We talked about agriculture and soil as a resource in agriculture and different ways that we replace that resource. We talked about energy intensity in agriculture. We talked about carbon in agriculture. And we talked about sort of the big picture about world food supply and productivity growth in agriculture versus population growth globally. And we did global accounting, GNP and GDP, introduced those terms. Talked about incorporating resources and green prices into those. We talked about environmental business error and how pollution would go up and go down in developing country. And in different countries with different rules about pollution and wood manufacturing moves to different places and different levels of environmental protection. Sustainability. And then in the last lecture, we did carbon. Do a protocol, California's carbon trade, Europe's carbon trade, the price of carbon, where we are with the price of carbon, and this abatement curve, I can put that on there, carbon abatement curve, which sort of is going to tell us where we need to go for the price of carbon. So what I wanted to try to do today was draw some of these basic graphs and maybe you guys could draw along with me to review. All right, so I put some graph paper and then on my digital pen so that we can webcast it, we'll see if this works. You guys have seen like the Khan Academy, right? Those videos. I'm really going to watch if you want to review for this class for sure, but this one can use it, so I kind of want to be like in this, like the cool flex classroom of the future is like where you make yourself a YouTube, make your kids can watch at home, and then we come to the classroom and like we work through problems. That's the lecturing class. So that's sort of this vision of how education is going to change. I'm not sure if I have that in my handwritings. I have this with the digital pen, but hopefully I can do this more. So this is kind of a curve. Oops, there's like a link over there. We need to label our axes so we have price and quantity. One thing in general, when we're thinking about graphs, is a lot of times our vertical axis is a rate, is like a dollars per unit. And our horizontal axis is some kind of units, right? So on a lot of our graphs, it's like that. There's a price or a rate on the upper side. And so our price is dollars per unit on the upper side, and then the number of units on the horizontal. So we started, I don't like that thing. So we started with the supply curve and the demand curve. First, a couple weeks of class, we were talking about bus trips to Yosemite, and there's an official point that we're solving for, QSR, and QSR. That line is really bad, I have to get better at this. So we have a QSR, we have a QSR, and we can, in the end of the economics, we can talk about what happens if we're off of QSR, like if we're above or below. Here, if we have Q greater than QSR, we have a surplus. Here, is Q greater less than QSR, we have a shortage. When we have a shortage, we're going to have a price that's higher than the equilibrium price. Producers are going to be incentivized to produce more, people are going to consume less. We're going to have quantity increasing and price decreasing as that happens to get us back towards equilibrium. If we have a surplus, the price is going to be really low, the producers are going to restrict their supply, cost them less quantity, and the price is, will slowly creep back up toward equal. See how if you just say I can erase this. There we go. And the other things we can do is we can have a shift in demand. Demand can go up to a new level, and a higher demand, we're going to have a higher price and a greater quantity. Demand shift in, we can have supply shift up, we can have supply shift down. We can come back to, let's see, should just go into the welfare. I am going to learn. All right, we'll go to welfare after we do some independent terms. All right, so we're going to look at the demand curve, which we get from this thing of indifference curves and budget constraints. So indifference curves are choices between two different goods that a consumer is consuming. So here, we're not going to have rates. We're going to have two different goods on the axis. And the consumer's getting utility from consuming bundles of these different goods. Here, he's consuming 20 of good 2 and 45 of good 1. Down here, he's consuming 55 of good 2 and only 20 of good 1. But there's some curve that connects those. It's concave, it's like moon-shaped. It doesn't touch either axis because at very low levels of, you know, the good, they're going to trade a whole bunch of units and we're going to want to have at least some open each of the units. And then we think, this is a constant utility for a whole bunch of different bundles that are the combinations. Along an indifference curve, we have a constant level of utility. So this one was 20 and 50, and this one was 45 and 20. So the consumer is indifferent between those two points. But then there will be a higher level of utility that we're going to have other bundles that are going to be indifferent to along those lines. We're going to have at least one of the goods out of the rear. And finally, where we're going to solve this is we're going to have income and prices. And those are going to make budget buy, budget constraint, how much they can afford. So we have the ratio of the prices makes the slope of the budget line. And income makes the intercept. So, where should this be? I'll do it the best. We have straight line, because it's just a ratio of two prices. This has the two prices in a ratio, that's the slope of the line. This intercept here is if we spent all of our money that we have on a good one. And this intercept here is if we spent all of our money on good two. And there's somewhere where these are tangent, this is where my awful drawing is getting really messy. There's some point where they're tangent, and this is the best point for this consumer. It's the highest utility. Like if there's, if there's a whole bunch of these curves, these utility levels would not be preferred. They'd be lower utility levels. And so at this point, adjacency is the highest utility level inference curve that the consumer can afford to get to. And so there's some chosen one level we could get to at this point of tangency, which here is 30 to 45. They can't afford it. These other two points that we had before, this point of tangency is the point that they can't afford it. So, can I raise this in server? Yeah, so there's another thing that we did here was by changing the prices we derived the demand curve. So we have one set of prices, and what we can do is we can hold the price of good one constant and hold income constant and vary the price of good two. And if we do that, that's going to change where this budget constraint goes. And the budget constraint is going to give us 3 points of tangency. So there's this point here, this point here. So now we have 3 points as the price line varies. And if we had a table, we could have the price of good two and the quantity of good two. And we could have a low price, the medium price, and the high price for these 3 lines. So the price we don't have on this graph, we have 3 prices. And then we could have them going from. So the low price is this dotted line up here. We're consuming 75 at this medium price, we're consuming 45, and the highest price, which is here, we're consuming 25, which is looking awful. But now we have the ability to make a demand curve from those 3 points. So we have a demand curve that comes out from varying those prices. 10 and 75, 20 and 45, that's right, this is 10 and 75. We consume 75 units at the price of 10, at the price of 20, and the price of 30. Here we consume 45, here we consume 25, so we've made a demand curve, we've got ourselves a demand curve by reading off indifference curves and the tangencies with the changing prices. So, the difference curves, the prices are going to give us the demand curve. You guys remember that one a little ago. Right, moving on to welfare analysis. We'll go back to having a regular supply, labeler graphs, P and Q. So, our starting point for welfare analysis is the efficient point. So one thing we want to think about our demand curve is we also call it our willingness to pay curve. So if our price is really high, there's only one person who wants to pay that really high price, who wants to sell a little bit. And as the price goes down, there's more people, there's more units that get sold. It's actually really summing up these columns of willingness to pay, of people who are willing to pay. But that's the area under the willingness to pay curve is the total willingness to pay. So demand curve, willingness to pay, area under demand, total willingness to pay. Our supply curve, which later when we're talking about costs, the area under the supply curve is how much it costs the firm to produce each unit. So the first unit is super cheap, they can produce super cheap. As production goes up, it's going to cost them a little more each time. And if we sum up all these rectangles that are under the supply curve, we only have total variable costs. So this area here would be variable cost. So the first unit variable cost to produce 2 units, it keeps going up. So the consumer surplus, the producers, are going to pay this much at P star, and their total willingness to pay is this area above there. So this triangle here